I'm a policy advisor to the European Commission. I'm a policy advisor to UNESCO organization. I'm a policy advisor to the Austrian government. I'm a researcher developing AI tools, and I'm a mother of two kids. And today I'm standing here to talk about the challenges associated with AI technology, with the design of AI technology. And no matter where you are, be it Australia, South America, North America, Europe, wherever, this is relevant to you. At the latest, since ChatGPT revolutionized the world 1 year ago, we know what a deep impact AI systems have on societies and on every one of us. The European Commission proposed in their ethics guidelines that trustworthy AI has to be lawful, it has to be ethical, and it has to be robust. But what does it mean to be ethical? How can we translate ethical values into the design? And how do we know, as customers, that a technology is trustworthy? Today, I'm talking about a fundamental right that has not received the attention it requires. I'm talking about the respect for human autonomy. And I'm talking about how AI technology can compromise this fundamental human right and why there is an urgent need for action. Human beings are sense makers. You know, when we observe our environment, when we observe how people behave, we cannot open their minds and read them. They are black boxes. So what we do is we attribute attentions to others. We attribute emotions and other human characteristics. That's very, very normal to attribute that because we have to make sense of our world around us. But we do the same with moving objects. Researchers found out when they presented a video similar to this one that people are not talking about triangles moving on the screen. They talk about someone playing hide and seek, is jealous or aggressive. This phenomenon is called anthropomorphism. So we anthropomorphize objects. And we use it in the design of AI tools because it eases the interaction with the AI tools and it creates familiarity and it allows us to create trust and technology acceptance. But it also comes with problems. It is associated with risks. The more we humanize AI technology, the more we run the risk that we build expectations in the technology which it is not able to hold. We might take what ChatGPT says as the truth, but in reality, it is hallucinating. Or we might assume that the car, the autonomous car we are sitting in, also recognizing rises that the person is crossing the street despite the red lights. We rely on that, but it might not have recognized it, but we have. And the second thing about it is that it might create attachment to the technology the more we humanize it. And that is not only a problem with the most vulnerable of us, it is a problem for every one of us. In this case, so imagine, for instance, our kids being attached to the toys they are giving. So in this case, we have to make sure that we design technology that has realistic expectation, that prevents emotional attachment to the tools, and that is transparent on its purpose. We are not very good in making decisions, particularly then when we have to process a lot of information, when the decision situation, the problem is very complex and difficult. So it's a wonderful idea to have AI technologies to support us in making decisions. But again, this may come with troubles. First of all, AI technologies are not telling the truth. Algorithms are trained with data that may be biased, incomplete, wrong, or corrupted. And AI technology is developed by human beings, so AI technology is a cultural artifact and hence plagued by the same problems and difficulties as human beings are. Second, imagine you go to your doctor and want him to look at your skin and identify whether you have skin cancer or not. And the doctor uses an AI tool to diagnose. Do you want him to leave this decision entirely to the system? Or do you want the doctor, having not the competence to decide whether it is cancer or not? So one of the issues here is that AI technologies in the loop change the roles of the experts in the place. They might not feel accountable anymore for the process and the outcome. They might rather feel that they are mediating between the technology and the client. We don't want to have that. We want to be, we have doctors that feel accountable for the process and for the outcome. And finally, you know, we all have doctors that have been trained currently in the old systems, so they are experts. But imagine in a couple of years when they never diagnose anymore because it is done by a system. How could they become experts in the first place? How could they build the competences in the first place? And if we don't use competences and skills we have, we lose them. So we have to design systems where we do not have the human in the loop. We have to design systems where AI is only in the loop and the human is always in the driver's seat, accountable for the process and the outcome. We want to have systems that allow experts to feel self-efficacy and to develop competences and a professional identity. And we want to hold experts accountable when they use AI systems. Humans have an extraordinary and very important advantage over AI systems. We know the importance of values. We can empathize with others. And we do understand the consequences of our behaviors. We are moral agents. AI systems are not. So when we want that AI systems comply with the values we have to build values into the design. And I give you one example again. In the area of medical treatment. Think about the elderly, right? Think about the situation that everyone is crying for robotic support to resolve the care crisis we are facing because we are not having enough people to take care of all the elderly. Think about the situation of elderly care homes. So we have a couple of stakeholders in there. One group of stakeholders is the providers of elderly care. They are responsible to ensure human dignity in the whole process. They are responsible to ensure that there is safety and that human rights are respected. So they're interested in AI technology is, in the first place, having control over the process, having documented processes, etc. The caregivers, they have chosen their profession because they want to do something good. They want to help other people. They want to have a meaningful job. And their expectation in the technology is to be supported in that very heavy work, for instance, in lifting patients and people. And not least, the people receiving care. Think about perhaps your grandmother suffering from dementia and having other impairments. She wants to live a high-quality life with the most autonomy as possible. She doesn't want people telling her what to do, right? So all of these values are important. But then imagine there are situations where these values do not go together. What about if your grandmother decides to stop eating and drinking? Can she be forced? At one point, you know, at one point, it is so dangerous for your health that you're gonna have to decide either as a caretaker or as an institution, we have to do something about it. Would you leave this decision entirely to AI technology? We can't. Again, we have the situation here that we have people, human, in the loop. So we have to design systems. In the design, we have to integrate the relevant stakeholders from scratch very early. We have to consider societal goals. And yes, the systems need to be transparent. I'm a scientist developing robotic technology. I'm a policy advisor to the European Commission, to UNESCO, and the Austrian government. And I'm a mother of two kids. And I'm claiming that we need to tame this technology. The negotiation agreement of the European Commission just recently on the European AI Act is only a first step. Human rights are universal, and so regulation has to be global. So please support us in our initiative to spread and to get the European regulation on a global level. This technology is too important to handle it carelessly. I want to get it right. We want to get it right. We have to get it right. Thank you.